In the 13th year, in the 4th month, on the 5th day of the month, as I was among the exiles by the Chebar Canal, the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God. The nation of Israel was in captivity to Babylon. The thing about kingdoms is they have borders. Wars often break out over lines drawn on a map indicating where one king's authority ends and another king's authority begins. In ancient Near Eastern cultures, this thinking extended to their gods as well. People, groups had a pantheon of certain gods, and their chief god had jurisdiction over the land. In fact, when nations went to war, they believed their gods to be fighting as well. The majority of us probably think very differently. We may think that the true God's authority has no limits, and we would be absolutely right. The problem is what we see going on in God's territory. We reflect on things like natural disasters, disease, war, terrorism, and we wonder, why would God allow such things to plague his world? We also reflect on difficulties that are a little closer to home. Someone we love killed in an automobile accident, our property being stolen, divorce, untimely deaths. We wonder, who's really running this kingdom? Israel, while in Babylon, they may have wondered if God had been defeated by Marduk, the chief god of the Babylonians. They may have wondered if God was even on his throne at all. I mean, after all, Judah had been defeated. Perhaps it was their personal circumstances that hit the hardest. They'd lost their homes, their businesses. Many had lost family members to war and seen others separated by exile. They needed to see God and see God as he truly is. In this context, God gave Ezekiel a vision of his throne room. Now, I want to point out that a vision is not like a security camera. Visions portray truths using symbols and signs. And it's somewhat difficult for us to imagine what Ezekiel describes, but we can get the clear point. And once we get our bearings, this vision will captivate us with the glory of God on his throne. In the center of the storm, Ezekiel saw four living creatures, and he identifies them as cherubim, winged throne bearers. These beings would not have been unusual for Israelites to picture, as many Near Eastern cultures depicted them in their worship art. The most important background for cherubim in the Bible comes from Exodus 25, where Israel was instructed by God to make two cherubim of gold and to sit them atop the sacred box that would hold the tablets of the Ten Commandments and would rest in the holy place in the temple. Israel understood that God was enthroned above the cherubim, not in the box. So, when Ezekiel begins to describe the cherubim, his hearers would have immediately started to anticipate a vision of who was above the cherubim. Four faces, powerful faces, a man, a lion, an ox, an eagle. My biggest takeaway from that is that even the most powerful things in the universe, they're all subservient to God. In Ezekiel's vision, the cherubim were moving. Cherubim were not only winged throne bearers, they flew wherever the Spirit of the Lord directed them. God's throne is not stuck in one place. His servants, they're on the move, ready to go wherever he wills. As we envision what Ezekiel describes, we should picture the winged servants of the Lord carrying a mobile throne. Ezekiel was fascinated by the mobility of these creatures and the mobility of God's throne. After all, a throne that's mobile means a kingdom without borders, a king without rival, a king that cannot be challenged. What part of your life do you feel are outside of God's borders? These might be areas where you don't see or understand what God is doing, or areas where you don't want God interfering. Either way, God wants us to understand that there's no limit to his sovereignty. His servants are on the move. Heavenly Father, how privileged we are to have such an astonishing peek into the appearance of the likeness of the glory of God in Ezekiel's amazing vision. We see you seated on your heavenly throne, surrounded by those who serve you, transported by magnificent living creatures. No words are sufficient to convey the greatness of your glory, and yet, your goodness and grace, you've given us a glimpse of your majesty in heaven. There are no words to express how great is your endless wisdom, your boundless power, your never-ending purity. We praise your glorious name. We praise your holy name. Blessed be the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. God bless you. I'll see you tomorrow.